Good evening. My name is Michael House. I'm Senior Vice President here at the National World War I Museum and Memorial. Welcome, or for many of you, welcome back. We're very glad to see you. Glad you could be here this evening. Since 1941, Congress and the Department of Defense have reviewed the military's process for awarding Valor Medals to ensure minority veterans were recognized equitably. No review has occurred for World War I veterans until now. The Valor Medals Review is being conducted by Park University's George S. Robb Centre for the Study of the Great War and the Valor Medals Review Task Force, which was formed last August in conjunction with the Foundation for the Commemoration of the World Wars on behalf of the U.S. World War I Centennial Commission. Tonight's program is presented in partnership with Park University and the National Archives at Kansas City, two perennial partners we are thrilled to be collaborating with again this evening. We have the honor of hosting moderator Kimberly Reed, Public Affairs Specialist, National Archives at Kansas City, and our panelist, Dr. Timothy Westcott, Associate Professor of History and Director of Park University's George S. Robb Center for the Study of the Great War, and Bridget Locke, Director of Strategic Communications at Park University. Please welcome Bridget Locke.
Thank you, Michael, and hello, everyone. It is indeed an honor to spend the evening talking about Park's Road to and Role in the World War I Valor Medals Review, and I can't think of a more fitting venue. The National World War I Museum and Memorial is, after all, a beacon of pride, reverence, and gratitude, where those who valiantly defended our nation in the Great War are remembered and their stories are told. It is also fitting to be here tonight because Park University's journey to this work began in this exact place some 3 years, 3 months, and 21 days ago. On February 29th, 2016, Park spent the evening here for our 15th annual Spencer Cave Black History Month lecture. The Spencer Cave Lecture is a yearly event that explores the many contributions that African Americans have made toward our nation's success while paying homage to its namesake, the hardworking and wise Mr. Spencer Cave, a man born into slavery at the start of the Civil War and after moving to Parkville, Missouri in 1875, worked for our institution for 72 years until his death in 1947. In 2016, our guest lecturer for the Spencer Cave series was Dr. Jeffrey Sammons. I will get this right. A very accomplished author, lecturer, activist, and professor of history at New York University. A couple of years prior to his Spencer Cave lecture, Dr. Sammons, along with Dr. John Morrow Jr. of the University of Georgia, co-authored the book Harlem's Rattlers and the Great War: The Undaunted 369th Regiment and the African American Quest for Equality. Contained within its pages is an account of First Lieutenant George S. Robb, a Park University alumnus who led the mostly black 369th Regiment, 93rd Division of New York. Lieutenant Robb's service eventually led to his receipt of the Medal of Honor for extraordinary heroism. His story is that while serving in Seychelles, France in September 1918, he was severely wounded in action. Rather than retreat to the rear for treatment, he remained with his platoon until ordered to the dressing station by his commanding officer. Then he returned and remained on duty throughout the night. Lieutenant Robb was wounded again multiple times the next day and survived wounds from a bursting shell that killed his commanding officer and two officers of his company. Still, he assumed command and organized position in the trenches. In the end, he was the only officer of his battalion who advanced beyond Seychelles and contributed largely to his battalion's ability to hold their objective. So, Dr. Sammons came to town and told his story. His lecture, George S. Robb, From Salina, Kansas to Park University to Pershing's 100 Heroes of the War, offered insight into Lieutenant Robb's life before, during, and after the war. But during his stay, Lieutenant Robb isn't the only soldier that Dr. Sammons talked about. He was equally passionate about another serviceman, Sergeant William A. Butler. Dr. Sammons shared with Park University's president, Dr. Greg Gunderson, that he had been working diligently in pursuit of the Medal of Honor for Sergeant Butler for a number of years. Sergeant Butler's story was also a brilliant display of heroism. In August of 1918, Sergeant Butler, who served in Company L of the 369th Infantry Regiment, 93rd Provisional Division, which fought with the French 16th and 161st Divisions, distracted a group of German soldiers who seized First Lieutenant Gorman Jones and four other American soldiers. Sergeant Butler and the captured Lieutenant Jones exchanged directions verbally, and Sergeant Butler confused the enemy raiders, which allowed captured Americans to escape. Then he charged ahead while shooting his automatic rifle from the shoulder rather than from a tripod, as it was designed to be fired. So during this exchange, Sergeant Butler killed four enemy soldiers, wounded an officer who later died, and continued to pursue the enemy raiders who were now fleeing. Sergeant Butler's actions prevented the capture of men and intelligence, and were so swift and powerful, the enemy raiders recorded that their raid was repelled by great numerical force and firepower. This one brave man was mistaken for many brave men. For his heroic actions, Sergeant Butler, a Maryland native, was honored with Francis Croix de Guerre with Palm by Order of the Army, the highest level of this award, and the U.S. Army's Distinguished Service Cross. You'll notice on the screen that Sergeant Butler was also recommended for the Medal of Honor in November 1918, at the same time, on the same form as Lieutenant Robb. Medal of Honor recommendations were extremely rare for African American soldiers at the time, which serves as further testament to his valor. However, evidence shows that his recommendation may have been considered, then downgraded. In fact, history bears out that the Croix de Guerre and Distinguished Service Cross were the highest honors afforded to African American soldiers during their times of service in World War I. In support of the effort to have Sergeant Butler's Medal of Honor recommendation reconsidered, Dr. Sammons compiled a thick stack of evidence, hundreds of pages, that spoke to Sergeant Butler's valor, but unfortunately, those efforts stalled. President Gunderson heard the story of Sergeant Butler and was moved by the passion that Dr. Sammons felt for this soldier's story. So he offered Park University's full support in helping him move it forward, because helping a hero to receive his just due aligns with our university core values of accountability, civility and respect, excellence, global citizenship, inclusivity and integrity, walks in lockstep with our century-long support of the military, past, present, and future, and supports our strengthening strategic focus on inclusion, diversity, and community engagement. Actively engaging in Sergeant Butler's cause was an organic extension and expression of this work and was true to who we've always been as a university community. So, we launched an awareness campaign in 2018 through change.org. People from across the nation and from countries around the world, Canada, Belize, France, Germany, Ghana, Guam, Iraq, the Netherlands, Russia, and South Korea, signed this petition posted by President Gunderson in support of Sergeant Butler's receiving the Medal of Honor posthumously. During that time, while the interest grew around Sergeant Butler's story, the World War I Centennial Commission in Washington, D.C. began having discussions about broadening the scope, specifically because there were many more stories like Sergeant Butler's to be told, World War I soldiers of color who had served valiantly but were perhaps denied medals of honor due to race. It was determined that the time had come for a systematic review on a larger scale, due in large part to Park's work with Sergeant Butler and our connection to Dr. Sammons. Dr. Timothy Westcott and I got invited to that conversation in Washington, D.C., and eventually became members of the Valor Medals Review Task Force. So, now that I've taken you on a quick journey from Kansas City to D.C., I'd like to join Kimberly Reed and Dr. Tim Westcott and we can discuss where this work stands today.
Thank you very much, Bridget. And thank you both for joining me this evening and providing the overview of Park University's involvement in this important effort. I want to start by asking, what exactly is the Valor Medal review process? How does it work once a veteran is identified as possibly not having been honored?
Well, thank you and welcome to everyone here. Kimberly, for hosting. Michael, for your comments again. There are three service medals that fall within Valor. There is the Silver Star, which is the third one. In the middle is the Distinguished Service Cross, which is the United States Army. And then there's the Navy Cross, which is the equivalent to that within the Navy and the Marine Corps. And then there's the Medal of Honor. To receive a Valor Medal, there has to be an act of distinguished valor on a battlefield that can be verified by at least two eyewitnesses to the physical or actual act of valor. So as you can imagine, we're talking 101 years ago, so finding those individuals
might be hard.
Eyewitnesses to be found hard. But let me give you a little bit of data. There were approximately 5,800 Distinguished Service Crosses awarded during World War I and approximately 1,300 Navy Crosses. So we're talking a lot of individuals that received recognition for acts of valor. We have started with 70 of the Distinguished Service Cross, and those are primarily the 70 African Americans that we are researching. So we haven't even looked into the Navy Crosses yet for any of the five groups, which we'll talk about later, from that point. So that's sort of where we are and what classifies as a valor or a valor medal, okay, you know, from that point. Once we have received documentation or verification of a DSC, and if you know, during World War I, African Americans were in segregated units, so that's where we started because in some sense it's easier to locate the names to start with and then start the research. So there are three young individuals up front here that sort of is part of the team. Sarah has already graduated, but there's Josh and Ashlyn, who are current history majors, and myself. So Ashlyn basically is responsible for the biographical and the genealogical searching. And then Josh becomes our, what we call, military expert, and we can definitely get into that earlier or later. So we start looking at archive records, and thank you all for the National Archives, because the St. Louis Center is our best friend right now. We've been lucky enough that Jeff Sammons, who you heard about earlier, had a contact there when he was doing the book. So the rest of us would send in an SF-180 form requesting information on a relative or something. It would be just sort of given to the next clerk in line. Ours goes directly to that archivist that's in St. Louis, and he personally handles all of these SF-180s, which also provides him an opportunity to search the archival records nationally, so we don't have to keep going everywhere else in that sense. So that comes to us, then we do the genealogical. Ashlyn said earlier today, you know, thank goodness for Ancestry.com and Fold 3, because we can get a lot of information, particularly genealogical. Then I have the great pleasure, after that, of contacting the descendants, if we can locate them, which so far we've been pretty successful. I've spoken to two daughters of veterans, and then basically grandchildren. So we also then try to get the genealogical family records from them. And then we bring all that back and start creating the narrative. Mm-hmm. We have to meet current Medal of Honor standards, not standards from 100 years ago. So that means, and again, Josh can answer this better than I. We have to have the longitude. We have to have the latitude. We have to have the weather at 1,000 hours on September 28th, 1918, in the Meuse Argonne Forest that has to go on the application. Josh can verify that French do not keep good records, but Germans do. And then we have to have the maps of right then and there. That all now has to be in the application with those two verifiable first-person accounts. So then I think we'll have a chart that'll go up.
Yeah, I was going to say, I know you have a slide that I think also helps explain some of this. And I do want to clarify for those of you in the audience, if you don't know what an SF-180 is, that's a standard Form 180, and that is a request for a military personnel file. So as Dr. Westcott was alluding to.
Those are the five groups that we are researching. African-Americans, Asian-Americans, Hispanic-Americans, Jewish-Americans, and Native Americans. And if you know our American history, Native Americans do not become full citizens until 1924. So we've gone even beyond them even becoming citizens.
And so step two of the process is they go through an and or test. So as the groups are whittled down, as a part of the review, we are looking at those who received the Distinguished Service Cross or the Navy Cross, the Croix de Guerre with Palm, and or Medal of Honor recommendation.
It becomes interesting to try to find the biographical, particularly. Genealogical, again, it's not too bad. But then we have to take that and match that up with actual, verifiable, because one of the most recent recipients, the Jewish American, in 2015, his daughter still lives in Missouri. So we were able to contact her, very supportive, but she was relaying the story, which makes our work somewhat more difficult, is that her father was not old enough to join the Army. So after the United States declares war, her father comes home, confronts his father, her grandfather, and basically says, I need you to come down to the center so I can sign up to go to war. And Dad said, no, you're not old enough. And this lady's father said, well, we can do this one of two ways. You can sign me in as old enough, or I promise you, you will never see me again. So, father went down, but what's that do? There's a wrong birth date on the registration card. So when we're trying to find birthdays, some of that information isn't always correct. We had, for another example this week, is the Hispanic American, the only one that we know of, that received the Medal of Honor. His mother was Mexican American, Hispanic. His father was Caucasian. He registered under the C, his father's race. Mm-hmm. We would never have known that. Luckily, we had brand new found friend at the Congressional Budget Office that let us know. So those are some of those twists and turns that we have to go through because information may not match. We will then write a narrative. We have promised so far every family member we have located, and we've also promised the World War I Centennial Commission that every service member that we will look at will have a narrative. Now, they may not be moved up to the particular secretary, but we will tell their story. That could be 125, it could be 375. Their story will be told. Then there is the Medal of Honor recommendation, which we can talk about later.
And this final step, I believe, is the task force review. Can you talk a little bit about why the Commission and the Robb Centre are focused on underrepresented groups? You've alluded to that a little bit already, but why that is so important. And I believe Park University in particular has a history around some of these groups.
Absolutely. So I can speak from the Park University perspective. From our very beginning, from day one, being concerned for and a champion for underrepresented groups, it's just woven into the fabric of who we are as an institution. So we talk a lot about our original group of students. We call them the original 17, and included in that group of students were Native American and female students, which was kind of rare for the time. So it is really just a part of our foundation. And our mission is to transform lives through accessible, student-centered, quality higher education. And so in doing that, the way that bears out for us, we are laser-focused on serving those who serve our country and also serving those who might not otherwise be served. So a couple of proof points. So again, we've got the students who originally came as a part of our foundation, but also there's an example in the early 1940s after the bombing of Pearl Harbor during World War II. As we all know, there were American-born people of Japanese descent who were sent into internment camps. These people were called Nisei. And so our president at the time, Dr. William Young, learned about this practice and he was appalled. And so what he did was he went into an internment camp and he retrieved 9 students and he allowed them to study at Park University. That was not a popular decision, just on the whole. It was met with a little bit of controversy, but that's another example of how we just champion underrepresented groups. And so being a part of this work, it's really a part of who we are. It is just core to what we believe about serving those who might not otherwise be served.
I want to maybe take a little different, more of a professional perspective. Mm-hmm. Two professions. As a veteran of the United States Marine Corps, and Josh is also a veteran, Sarah has served, is, first of all, there's a connection automatically to that. As a historian, I believe that we have an obligation within that historical narrative or even that national narrative, our story, to investigate historical wrongs. I'm not sure how many of you may be aware, but this morning in the U.S. House of Representatives, H.R. 40 was discussed in front of a committee. H.R. 40 is hopefully would establish a commission to look at reparations. I'm quite sure that of this part of the 70 African Americans that we are currently looking at, if we dug way back, there would be some slavery ties to our nation's history, you know, from that perspective. In 1925, the Commandant of the Army War College wrote a report. I'm not going to quote that report because it would be so inhumane today to say what he wrote regarding the perspective of having African Americans serve in the U.S. Army. This was an official report to his boss, okay? So there, we know that there is, or was at the time, a point of bias. Approximately 4.7 million men and women of the United States served in World War I. A little over a million of those were in those five groups that were on that screen. So basically 22% of the Americans that served in World War I were either African American, Asian American, Hispanic American, Jewish American, or Native American. 120 medals of honor have been received by World War I veterans. 120. Seven belong to those groups. 113 were awarded to Caucasians. Two to African Americans, and those have only been recently. Okay. Four Jewish Americans, one Hispanic. No Native American or no Asian Americans received the Medal of Honor as of this date for service of valor in World War I. So, in my opinion, we have a national obligation to look at these service members.
Thank you. You both have alluded to the university's engagement with students. You mentioned the Nisei group, and you've mentioned that there is a core group of students right now that are working on this project. Can you speak a little bit about that? And I know that we have some of them here with us, and their involvement as well as the level of interest and the contributions that they're making to this project.
As an educator, which I've been now for more than 30 years, there's always a group of students that sort of tug at the heart. These three definitely do that, to say the least. They came in on board in September when we signed the MOU, President Gunderson signed the MOU, and they basically have really taken off on the project and research. Basically, we can leave them alone and they can do their work. Ashlyn is a senior, so just turned a senior. Josh just turned to be a sophomore. He just finished his freshman year. This is all undergraduates. We have no graduate program in history at Park. So these are undergraduate students doing the nature of the work that you've seen or will be hearing about. Ashlyn and Sarah were primarily, again, responsible for the biographical and the genealogical component, which means for us, looking for all service and non-service related records, primary, secondary sourcing that we all need, we're going to need, the family information, descendant information, which can be difficult by itself, no matter what. They draft the narratives and correspond with historical societies. Josh is really our military man, to say the least. Again, he's responsible for all that military stuff that we have to be able to put into the application. And then we all work together, to make that from that point. So
it really has become a team effort. And I know it is a time-intensive effort as well. Anyone who's done the type of research knows that. Would you talk a little bit about this work as it falls under the Robb Centre and how the center was established? I know you alluded to that at the beginning. Why the beyond the initial relationship with Dr. Sammons and kind of how that fits into the university's mission and continuing that forward as this project takes off and what that vision will look like, if we know yet.
So again, when we talk about the mission of Park University to transform lives through accessible, student-centered, quality higher education, it is really important, I think, that we allow our students to have many experiences in that educational experience. And so when we talk about the students involved in this work and how we're so fortunate to have a center that is
the namesake of that center is an alumnus. I mean, we are modeling excellence through the generations, and so Lieutenant Robb was a hero, and it is our honor to further work as we look into historical findings and all of the work that this study will entail. It is our honor to carry his name forward and do things that are history changing, but under that umbrella to equip the next generation for research and, you know, giving them an experience that they might not otherwise get elsewhere, I think is really, it's an honor to be able to do. And in terms of how that work moves forward, I know that beyond the current study, we're looking ahead to what this work could evolve into beyond just the study and the recommendation for the Medal of Honor. Our sense is that it will evolve beyond recommendations. Would you like to talk a little bit about that?
If you know anything about Kansas, Robb was born in Assyria, Kansas. I do not believe it. There may be a stop sign in a crossroads of a gravel road today. So basically, we always say Salina. That's sort of where he planted his name in that sense. If you don't know anything much about Robb, he is a 1912 graduate, goes to Columbia University, New York City, graduates with a master's in 1915, and then in 1935 is appointed by then Kansas Governor Alfred Landon as the Kansas State Auditor, which a post he held until 1960. He passes away in 1972. There's a famous picture that his grandson has given us that, I mean, he was a staunch Republican. He got invited, I think in 1962, by the President of the United States to visit the White House and have lunch, I think Harry says. Yes, Hannity. And there's a picture of President Kennedy shaking George's hand, and you can almost see the tension in George's hand, his face, because they're not standing very close to each other either. You know, I really do have to shake this guy's hand, right? You know, type thing. But you know, from that point, in 2005, there are two grandsons living. There's one lives in Duluth, one lives in St. Louis, that have had a long connection to Park College and then Park University in 2000. And the oldest grandson was visiting the archives in Topeka to do some research, and he stopped by, and we had an opportunity to talk. And they decided as a family to form what was known as the George S. Robb Center. 5 years later, we placed a plaque on campus. We have two Medal of Honor recipients that are alumnus, George Robb, from this war, and I saw a gentleman in the back that has a Korea war hat, Colonel Millett, Lewis Millett, from World War II, Korea, and Vietnam, received a Medal of Honor for his actions in Korea. So we have two of them. So the family helped us put a marker in for that and have been long time supporters of the center itself. They come back every couple years and given oral interviews and stuff like that. This is a 5 to 7 year project, so I hope none of you thinking we're getting done by Christmas, or quote unquote, we'll be home by Christmas, to say the least. 5 to 7 years, then, and I think our opinion, we'll probably have to, the story will not be done. This type of project may be done, but there's probably many, many stories that we can work with, particularly this institution, with telling.
Right, that will rise to the surface,
yes,
as part of this research effort. And I don't think many people knew who Lieutenant Robb was.
Correct.
And so that right there provides a great opportunity. You kind of led into my next question, which is, where are you at right now with those that you've identified? How many do you think are left to go? Or you may not have the answer to that question. How many are left to go? And then kind of the next part of that question is, This doesn't happen in a vacuum. There are many partnerships and relationships that contribute, and can you speak to that as well? So it's kind of a multi-part question there.
And this is an early estimate. We think we probably will review 125 to 150 service members within all five groups. Again, that's probably pretty conservative, you know, from that point of it. And there is federal legislation pending in the Senate. It's S-1218. In H.R. 2249, which is now part of the National Defense Authorization Act, or NDAA, that we continue to shepherd through both chambers of Congress with wonderful partners, particularly our VFW partners here in Kansas City and in D.C. We have phenomenal legislative staff support. Senator Van Hollen's staff, Van Hollen is from Maryland, Democrat. He sort of introduced a bill in April in Maryland. His co-sponsor is our own Senator Blunt from Missouri. So they both co-sponsored the Senate bill, to say the least. So, and very active in continuing. There are 22 senators that have currently co-sponsored the Senate side. On the House side, the legislation was introduced by Representative French Hill from Arkansas, and he had some connectivity to the Henry Johnson case. It's one reason why we asked him. He's a Republican. Then there were two others that co-sponsored with Representative French Hill, Emmanuel Cleaver and Sam Graves. And I, before I forget, there's a young gentleman that just walked in here a little bit ago, Josh Schubert. First of all, let me say he's one of our alums. But he's also Sam Graves, field representative in Kansas City. So Josh has been a wonderful support here at the local site to have us reach to the congressman, but also give us information and has that connectivity to the DC office. And I want to acknowledge Josh's support tonight since he's in the back. There are five systematic reviews, like I said in the past, so this will take us a while. We would maybe ask for, you heard me say there's a senator in Missouri that is co-sponsoring. You didn't hear me say the other one. There's only been one senator in Kansas that has signed on, and that is Senator Moran. So if you have any connectivities to those other two senators, I think I would appreciate some support in the Senate. The House side, we're in good shape on the Missouri side, except for probably Hartzler from a little further east. And we have made a connectivity to Sharice Davids, although she hasn't co-sponsored. And so, again, that would be a great tie. You know, she has some Native American heritage that we reached out to her to help us support for that group from there. So that's where we are at that point. We are, President Gunderson and I will be shortly going to visit the president of Haskell Indian Nations University in next week to make that. They had 400 alumni and students from Haskell serve in World War I. So we're going to reach out and, you know, tell them about the project, but make that, again, make that connection to their student body and to their and to their alumni, we hope, in that sense. So
I know we have a slide. Yeah.
It
we also, in addition to the kind of the political perspective, we've garnered some great support at a national level. And so, of course, the United States World War I Centennial Commission, which is kind of where this a lot of this started. And we've been working in partnership with the United States Foundation for the Commemoration of the World Wars. And then we have also garnered some support from the Congressional Black Caucus Veterans Brain Trust. We did present before them in September of 2018 as this study was just starting to get off the ground. And then, of course, the Veterans of Foreign Wars, they've been greatly greatly supportive, and the American Legion as well. So we're really gaining ground, and this is getting some steam, and we've got some really great support, local and national level.
Along with that, we have received about two dozen members of military service organizations or veteran service organizations. I've getting to learn a lot of acronym, you know, MSOs, VSOs, whatever type things. And then a colleague of mine at the university, we've also visited Chicago a couple of times because you have the 370th Friends Association, which, if you know anything about particularly African Americans in World War One, you had the 369th, i.e. Harlem Hellfighters, or you had the 370th out of Chicago. Those were the two massive infantry units that were almost engaged daily once they landed in Europe, and then were given sort of farmed out to the French army from that. So we have made those connections also to make sure those family members, and there are actual descendants in that group that we've reached out to. So.
Very good. I have one last question before we begin to open it up to audience questions. If someone thinks that they may have a veteran in their family that has been overlooked for a potential Valor Medal or recognition, what are the steps they should take to begin to pursue that, and who should they reach out to, and how does that work?
By the legislation, we can only look at those five groups based upon those three criteria. Either, you know, the Distinguished Service Cross, Navy Cross, and or the Croix de Guerre with Palms, and or we have archival verification of a nomination. As a team, we have made a concerted decision that we will be interested in talking to anyone that thinks a family member may have been overlooked for a Medal of Valor right now. We will maintain information from descendants, family members. So, again, in 5 to 7 years, we can pick up where we leave off on this one. You know, our only caveat is you understand there's more. There is a priority based upon the legislation. I mean, to be honest with you, on Friday, DOD came to Senator Van Hollen's office with four concerns, and the first concern was, well, can't you finish this in 5 years? Wait a minute. Every other review you've done have taken 8 years with one group. Oh, I could go back for 25 years. 5 times 5 is 25. No, they didn't like that. So there's probably going to be a constraint of time set by Congress at this point. So what we do want that information. And as an archivist and as a historian, we need the information also for, as look where we're at, and Jonathan knows this as well as I do, you know, sitting in the back. It's to have the information safe and stored and preserved and so on, that we can help you as a family member or family, that we can work with Jonathan here at the National World War One Museum and Memorial to preserve those artifacts, those documents, those letters those diaries, those journals and stuff. So we will take it. The students will pass out a sort of a postcard here in a minute. You can just email us and we'll get back to you. But we do want the information, because I think it's as we need to preserve it, and we will get to it. So hopefully that answers that question.
Yes, I think now before we transition into Q&A, we would like to show a video that summarizes this work.
America shares a sacred bond with the souls who swore to defend her. Sadly, history has not always been kind to every service member who fought abroad for our freedom. There have been systematic reviews of the military's process for awarding Valor Medals in World War II, the Korean War, the Vietnam War, and all subsequent American wars, but no review has been completed for World War I until now. In June 2018, a resolution of the U.S. World War I Centennial Commission established the World War I Systematic Review and Valor Medals Review Task Force. The purpose? To analyze the service records of African Americans, Hispanic Americans, Jewish Americans, Native Americans, and Asian Americans against a set of criteria to determine if discrimination played a role in their being denied Medals of Honor. The goal? That all World War I heroes whose acts of valor warrant the Medal of Honor receive it. Research is being conducted by Park History Majors in conjunction with the George S. Robb Centre for the Study of the Great War, the United States World War I Centennial Commission, and the U.S. Foundation for the Commemoration of the World Wars. The efforts are officially endorsed by the American Legion, the Congressional Black Caucus Veterans Brain Trust, and the Veterans of Foreign Wars of the United States. Visit gsr.park.edu to learn more.
We get to read their stories. We get to know what they've done to earn that valor, the Medal of Honor.
I'm a history major, so I really love doing this research.
At this time in history, the African-American soldiers weren't given the same rights as everyone else.
I'm the one that's supposed to figure out like the more detailed stuff of what actually happened, like the weather and the enemy provisions, what kind of effect that a particular soldier had on the enemy.
On the submission of a Medal of Honor, you have to have longitude, latitude, weather, actual military maps of that day or engagement or hour.
For me, especially as a veteran, it's important for people to know our stories.
Especially since they were American soldiers, they had a profound effect on stopping the German advance and overcoming the Germans.
For what we're doing not only affects the service member, but affects the families and every one of these individuals.
Somebody could hear about this project and see what research I did or Sarah did or Josh did, and that'll open up doors for them.
I believe we have time for a few questions, and Camille has a microphone, and she is over here off to the side. So if you have a question, please raise your hand, and I think she will come to you. And I see one already.
Thank you. Good evening. My question is, as a layperson, how can we assist you in this project?
Which one of you want to field that?
I'll start and then you weigh in. I think one of the final things that Dr. Westcott talked about was, you know, accepting information from all sources, even though the legislation is very specific. I think we've experienced just the power of word of mouth and how people have just started to talk about family history and stories that they've heard, and I think that's really led to the discovery of just some great stories and some leads. And so if you have a sense that there might be a person who would be a good candidate for this research, share it. I think that's first and foremost. Also, to talk about it. I think one of the important outcomes of this entire initiative is that we are talking about our servicemen in really important ways. Maybe some of these stories might have been forgotten. I think many of us have accepted that during that period of history, the standards by which people were treated were different, right? I think sometimes time and space allows you to just accept injustice. But I think as we start to talk about this, as this project starts to gain steam, I think it's so helpful for us to look at how everyone was treated and to really be intentional about making sure those who deserved something better receive it. I just think it's important that we're advocates for this work. So just continue to talk about it. Just continue to talk about it and share what you know.
And to follow up on the advocacy for a second, I received yesterday an email from a gentleman in Puerto Rico. Over Memorial Day, a government entity in Puerto Rico had put up a brand new marker for 15 Puerto Ricans that had been served in World War I, but had been forgotten. So he forwards me the 15 names, which we now have passed on, which will go in file so we can look at them within that one group. So advocacy, word of mouth, that's sort of how more recently we've been getting the personal stories, but the group stories. One of the aspects of the legislation that I think makes it different than the five previous systematic reviews. In the five previous systematic reviews, you and I as taxpayers have paid for those. DOD has supplemented by appropriations those five systematic reviews. The current legislation in front of both chambers has no federal appropriations requested. Under the guidance of President Gunderson in the back, it was our determination that we, at least initially, at this point in time, would not be asking for federal appropriations. So this project is run on the good graces of the university right now. Some forthcoming announcements regarding, some donors. But the young people here will pass out a card here in a minute. We are accepting donations. Let's be front. From that point. But we've decided not to seek. We, as an institution and a team, desire to have the flexibility to do the research the way research should be done and not be under the pressure of DOD or you have to do this group first or, oh no, Al, we want you to go to this unit first because they may have a celebration coming up or somebody wants something. No, we've determined we'll go through the process of the research. So.
Thank you.
Our next
couple other questions.
Yep, we have one more question in the back here and then Kelton will end.
Thank you. I really appreciate the work you all are doing. I know personally that time erases a lot of this history. When I was 18 years old in 1970, I learned that my mother's father, ostensibly my grandfather, who I never knew, had died in World War I. And in my family, he was written off, My grandmother married another man. He became grandpa, and a soldier in 1917 was lost. So this is meaningful to me in that sense. For the historical perspective you're talking about, I've always been interested in history. I've been particularly interested in World War I, and I'm aware that, and Dr. Westcott, you mentioned this, that when African-American troops first arrived in France and in Belgium in World War I, they were integrated into French forces. And you may have indirectly answered my question. You're recognizing the award of the Croix de Guerre with a palm. I'm curious, African-American soldiers serving in the French military, were they, in the technological sense of how all the relationships worked, eligible for American Medals of Valor like the Distinguished Service Cross and the Medal of Honor or the Silver Star, or because they were serving in French units, were they uniquely awarded French medals?
Both. Let's go back to Butler. He received all three, quote unquote, Single Service Cross, Croix de Guerre with palms, and a Medal of Honor recommendation. Now, that's why Bridget and I have come to the language of the and or, because not every one of them received all, either two or three. It could have been just Croix de Guerre with palm from the, or just the DSC. And they did receive other French awards also, but because the Croix de Guerre with palm is equivalent to a Medal of Honor, quote unquote, at that time to the United States, that's how we can somewhat relate that. But the point regarding your grandfather, the grandfather you did not know, between the end of military hostilities in 1925, so by November 1918 through December of 1925, 425,000 Americans that had served in the Great War were dead. Butler committed suicide, as a number of these individuals that we have begun to look at also committed suicide. Others died of disease and for other reasons. So if you think, you know, you think about 7 years, divide that by into 425. That's a lot of individuals that died that were veterans, that their stories will not be told unless we have their records. And and Bridget alluded to this a little bit. There are a number of service members we've looked at that could not read or write when they went into the U.S. Army, came out of the Army, still could not read or write because we had their X's on all their documentation. And life was hard before they went in, and life was more difficult when they came home due to disease conditions of World War I. Last thing, and then I'll get to the next question, is In our science building, there's a sort of an honor for Lieutenant Lloyd Boutwell that the science faculty are so honored to keep. And we've never known too much about the family. He was born and raised in Hamilton, Missouri, where J.C. Penney's grew up. And I think there's a famous quilt store there now or something I hear all the time from my mother. He's a 1911 graduate, so he would have known Robb, who graduated in 1912. Unbeknownst to even our archivist, who's been archivist for decades, we found out that our Lloyd Boutwell, who died in the war, had a son born after his death that he never saw, and to our understanding, may not have even known that his wife was pregnant. With Professor Hagman's help, we were able to track the grandson down in California, and we've spoken. And he did not know his grandfather. I mean, his father didn't even know his grandfather. So, or his father in that sense. So those stories are there, and we are reaching out in more diligent efforts now that we know we have a descendant to make that connectivity and to tell that story in that sense. Yes, sir.
This will be our last question. I just got to make sure you ask it with the mic. I need
to answer quickly. Kelton Smith, Is Park University and your group, have you ever collaborated with OMSA, the Orders and Medals Society of America, which is also tied in with the UK, and it's a worldwide organization, and they specialize in medals and decorations, and it's a high quality organization. There's also ASMIC, which Jim McDuff, one of our former board members, I think everybody knew him, but if you've ever contacted or worked through Fred Borth, they're a tremendous source of information, they really are.
I just want to say that you have proven my point, all the more reason why it's important for us to share this information so that we get good contacts and we are able to learn more and to collaborate in a strategic way. So thank you for that.
We have received from the French military the listing of the African-American DSC recipients that we currently are attempting to translate, since none of us know French. Luckily, we have a language teacher that does. So we are translating that, because it's important to us to compare that to the DSC citation. Because if there happens to be any variance, then there's another component that we have to deal with. The latter organization, yes. The former, no, and we will do that, because you're right. Both organizations are very, very knowledgeable of the medals and how they're described and so on. Yes.
Folks, if you have additional questions, our panelists will be available in the lobby for a bit. So on behalf of your National World War I Museum Memorial, thank you for joining us this evening, and let's give a round of applause to our panelists.